I had been working at the hospital for years, doing night shifts in the ER. For the most part, my nights were a blur of adrenaline and exhaustion, with only coffee and the endless hum of fluorescent lights keeping me from drifting off. But that night was different. It's been seared into my memory so vividly that I can still feel the cold sweat on my neck just thinking about it. It started around 2 a.m. when the waiting room was empty and the halls were eerily quiet. The silence felt heavy, pressing down on me as I sat at the nurse's station, flipping through patient charts. I was used to this kind of quiet. It was the lull before the storm, the kind of stillness that made you feel like something terrible was about to happen. But on this night, it felt wrong. Then the elevator dinged, breaking the silence. I glanced up, but no one stepped out. It was strange because the ER was on the ground floor, and only staff could use that elevator at night. I went back to my charts, chalking it up to a glitch, but the elevator dinged again. This time it was louder, echoing down the empty corridor. I felt a chill crawl up my spine, and against my better judgment, I decided to check it out. As I approached the elevator, the doors slid open. It was empty. I stood there for a moment, staring into the blankness. I knew it was just an elevator, but something about it felt off. Before I could turn back, the doors started to close. But just as they were about to shut completely, I swear I saw a shadow in the corner, something dark and twisted, just out of sight. My heart pounded as I stepped back, trying to shake off the feeling. I must have been tired, I thought, seeing things that weren't there. But then, just as I was about to walk away, I heard a whisper. It was faint, barely audible, but it was there. Help me, I froze. The voice was thin and desperate, coming from somewhere down the hallway. My instincts kicked in and I rushed toward the source, hoping it wasn't another late-night wanderer who'd lost their way. I moved down the hall, passing empty rooms with their lights dimmed, until I reached room 409. The door was ajar, and inside I could see someone lying on the bed. The room was dark, only lit by the faint glow of the machines, and the figure on the bed looked frail and sickly, barely moving. I could only make out the pale outline of their face, sunken eyes staring into the ceiling. I took a step inside, reaching for the light switch. Sir, are you okay? The figure didn't respond, but as I got closer, I realized something was wrong. The machines in the room weren't on. In fact, the whole room was dead silent, no beeping, no hum, nothing. My pulse quickened as I noticed the figure's chest wasn't moving. He wasn't breathing. Sir, I whispered, my voice shaking. Suddenly, his head turned sharply, his eyes locking onto mine. They were hollow, dark pits that seemed to stare right through me, filled with a kind of malice I'd never seen before. His lips twisted into a grotesque smile, and a raspy voice filled the room. You can't help me. I stumbled backward, barely able to breathe. My mind raced, trying to make sense of what I was seeing. I was about to turn and run when his hand shot out, cold and clammy, gripping my wrist. I yelped, trying to pull away, but his grip was impossibly strong. You can't leave, he hissed, his voice echoing in the silent room. I finally broke free, sprinting down the hallway, my heart pounding in my chest. I didn't stop until I reached the nurse's station, panting, my hands shaking. I wanted to call security, but I didn't know what to say. Who would believe me? As I stood there, trying to catch my breath, I felt a sudden draft. I turned around and saw the elevator doors opening again. My stomach dropped. The empty car sat there, waiting, as if it was inviting me back. Before I could react, the lights in the hallway started flickering, and a chill filled the air. The elevator doors began to open and close, the sound echoing through the empty halls. I took a step back, watching in horror, as shadowy figures began to appear in the dim light, standing just beyond the elevator. Their faces were twisted, gaunt, with eyes that looked hollow and lifeless, like they had been waiting there for centuries. Then I recognized one of them. It was a patient, Mr. Willis, who had died of a heart attack in the ER just a few weeks ago. He stood there, staring at me with the same lifeless eyes I had seen when he was wheeled into the morgue. And he wasn't alone. More faces appeared, patients who had passed away, each one staring at me, silent and still. A hand touched my shoulder. I jumped, spinning around to see my coworker, Sarah, standing there with a confused expression. You okay? She asked, glancing over my shoulder at the empty hallway. I looked back and the figures were gone. The elevator was closed and the hall was silent once again. I let out a shaky breath, nodding. Yeah, I'm fine. Just tired, I muttered, trying to shake off the lingering fear. But as the shift went on, I couldn't escape the feeling that something was watching me. I saw shadows out of the corner of my eye, heard faint whispers echoing down the halls. Every time I turned around, there was nothing there. By the time my shift ended, I was exhausted, my nerves frayed, and I could barely think straight. As I left the hospital, I glanced back one last time. For a moment, I thought I saw someone standing by the elevator, watching me. It was just a glimpse, a dark figure in the dim light, but I knew it wasn't just my imagination. To this day, I can't explain what happened that night. All I know is that something followed me home. I can still feel it sometimes, lurking in the shadows, watching me when I'm alone. And every now and then, in the dead of night, I hear the faint ding of an elevator echoing in the distance, as if it's calling me back. Story the end.
Story number two.
I had been working as an intern in the hospital for just a few months, covering night shifts and trying to make a good impression. It was an old building with endless twisting hallways and a creepy vibe that only seemed to intensify after dark. I'd heard stories from the other interns, tales of strange occurrences in the East Wing, but I brushed them off as just the usual hospital rumors. That was until I experienced something myself. It was a quiet night, around 3 a.m., and I was covering the East Wing alone. The East Wing had been mostly closed off for renovations, but the hospital was overcrowded, so they'd been using it for overflow. Only a few rooms were in use, and even then, most were empty. It was creepy enough walking down those dimly lit halls, but I didn't mind the quiet. It was a relief from the chaos of the ER. I was walking down the hall, checking in on patients, when I noticed something odd. At the end of the corridor, there was a door that I had never seen before. I'd been down that hallway dozens of times, and I was sure that there were only three rooms on that side, 402, 403, and 404. But now there was a fourth door, one with no number. It was just there, looming at the end of the hallway, the door slightly ajar. A chill ran down my spine, and I glanced around, hoping to see one of the other nurses who could confirm what I was seeing. But the hallway was empty, and the hospital was silent. I took a deep breath, deciding to check it out. Maybe it was just a storage room that I hadn't noticed before. As I approached the door, I felt the temperature drop. The air grew thick and heavy, and I could hear a faint, rhythmic beeping coming from inside, like the sound of a heart monitor. I pushed the door open and stepped inside, squinting in the darkness. The room was empty, bare except for an old, dusty hospital bed in the center. There were no machines, no monitors, nothing to explain the sound. I took a step closer, the beeping growing louder, and suddenly I felt an intense, suffocating feeling of dread. I turned to leave, but the door slammed shut behind me, trapping me inside. I tried the handle, but it wouldn't budge. Panic set in as I yanked on the door, desperately trying to open it, but it was like it had locked itself. "Hello?" I called out, my voice shaky. "Is anyone there?" There was no answer, only the steady beeping that seemed to grow louder, filling the room with its relentless rhythm. Then out of nowhere, a faint voice broke through the silence. "Please, help." I froze, my heart pounding. The voice was weak, barely a whisper, but it was unmistakably coming from the bed. I slowly turned around, my eyes adjusting to the dim light, and that's when I saw her. A woman lay on the bed, her face pale and gaunt, her eyes sunken and lifeless. Her skin was a sickly shade of gray, her hair matted against her skull. She stared at me with hollow eyes, her lips barely moving as she repeated, "Please, help me." I wanted to run, to scream, but I couldn't move. It was like something was holding me in place, forcing me to stay and watch. The woman's eyes seemed to bore into me, her expression twisted in a mixture of pain and desperation. "Please," she whispered again, reaching out a frail with a trembling hand. Her fingers were cold, icy, even though she was too far to touch me. I felt a chill crawl up my arm, spreading through my body like a wave of ice. I tried to pull away, but my feet felt glued to the floor. Suddenly, the beeping stopped, plunging the room into a silence that was even more terrifying. The woman's face twisted, her eyes widening as if in terror. She let out a blood-curdling scream, and in that instant, I felt an overwhelming urge to get out. I turned, yanking on the door with all my strength, and this time, it flew open. I stumbled out into the hallway, gasping for breath. The door slammed shut behind me, and when I looked back, it was gone. The wall was smooth, blank, as if the room had never existed. I stood there, my mind racing, trying to make sense of what had just happened. The next day, I asked one of the older nurses about it, hoping for some explanation. She gave me a strange look and told me there was no room without a number on that floor. But when I insisted, she hesitated, lowering her voice. "You must have seen the room with no number," she said quietly. "They say it appears to people when when someone is trapped there. Years ago, a woman died in that part of the hospital. She was forgotten, left alone in her room for hours before anyone found her. They say her spirit is still there, searching for someone to help her. I left that hospital soon after, unable to shake the feeling that she was still there, waiting in that empty room, hoping for someone to hear her cries for help. And every now and then, when I'm alone in a quiet place, I swear I can hear that faint, rhythmic beeping, like a heart monitor echoing in the distance, reminding me of the room with no number.
Story number 3.
During the graveyard shift, it wasn't unusual for strange things to happen in the old county hospital where I worked as a nurse. The building was ancient, full of creaks and drafts that only seemed to get worse at night. Everyone knew the stories about the abandoned wing, Ward C, where they used to treat tuberculosis patients back in the early 1900s. The wing had been sealed off decades ago, left to rot behind locked doors and crumbling walls. No one had been down there for years, at least that's what we thought. It was a little past 3 a.m., and the halls were dead silent. I was at the nurse's station, sipping stale coffee, when I heard the faint sound of footsteps echoing down the corridor. They were slow and deliberate, like someone was shuffling along in slippers. I glanced up, expecting to see one of the night shift doctors, but the hallway was empty. I stood up, peering down the corridor. The footsteps continued, growing louder, coming from the direction of Ward C. My heart skipped a beat. The only way someone could be coming from that direction was if they had somehow gotten into the abandoned wing. I thought it was strange, but figured it could be a lost patient or maybe a maintenance worker who didn't know the wing was off limits. I grabbed my flashlight and made my way down the hall. As I approached the heavy metal doors that marked the entrance to Ward C, I felt a chill settle over me. The air was colder here, almost as if the heat from the main wing couldn't reach this far. I hesitated, looking at the rusty chain that was supposed to lock the doors. To my horror, the chain was broken, hanging limply from the door handles. "Hello?" I called out, my voice echoing down the dark hallway beyond the doors. No answer, just the sound of something faint, a soft, rhythmic tapping like someone drumming their fingers on metal. I took a deep breath, pushed the doors open, and stepped into Ward C. My flashlight cast a narrow beam in the darkness, illuminating peeling wallpaper and cracked tiles. The smell was stale, like mold and old antiseptic. It was unsettling, but I told myself I was just being paranoid. The tapping continued, leading me deeper into the abandoned wing. The hallway was lined with rooms, each one filled with dusty hospital beds, old IV stands, and shattered glass. I peeked into one of the rooms, and for a moment, I thought I saw someone lying on a bed. A shadowy figure under a threadbare blanket. I shined my flashlight directly at the bed, but it was empty. I shook my head, trying to steady my nerves, and kept moving. As I reached the end of the hallway, I found a door slightly ajar, with a faint light flickering inside. My hands were shaking as I pushed the door open and stepped into what looked like an old examination room. There, sitting on the examination table, was an old man. He was thin, with gray, papery skin and hollow eyes that stared blankly at the floor. He was dressed in a faded hospital gown, the kind they hadn't used in years. He looked up at me as I entered, his eyes filled with an intense sadness that made my skin crawl. "Sir, are you okay?" I asked, trying to keep my voice steady. The man didn't answer, but he lifted his hand, pointing a bony finger at the wall. My flashlight followed his gesture, illuminating a row of dusty medical charts hanging on the wall. One of the charts caught my eye, and I stepped closer, squinting to read the name. My blood ran cold. It was his chart, patient 416, Thomas Mitchell. The date on the chart was from 1927. I turned back to the old man, my heart pounding in my chest. "Mr. Mitchell?" He nodded, his expression unchanging. Then in a voice barely above a whisper, he said, "I was the last one." "The last one?" I asked, confused. "They forgot me here," he continued, his voice thin and brittle. "Everyone left, and they forgot to come back for me." I felt a knot form in my stomach as the reality of his words sank in. Ward C had been closed off decades ago, abandoned when the hospital switched buildings, and they'd moved all the patients, except him. Somehow, he had been left behind. I'm so sorry, I stammered, unable to think of anything else to say. The old man looked at me, his eyes filling with tears. They promised they'd come back for me. They said it would just be a little while, but he trailed off, his gaze dropping to the floor. I waited. Suddenly, a loud crash echoed from somewhere down the hall. I jumped, spinning around, but there was no one there. When I turned back, the man was gone. The examination table was empty, covered in a thick layer of dust as if no one had touched it in years. The chart on the wall was gone too, replaced by an empty clipboard hanging on the nail. Panicked, I ran out of the room, my footsteps echoing down the empty corridor. I didn't stop until I reached the main wing, slamming the heavy doors behind me and gasping for breath. I tried to tell my supervisor what had happened, but she just laughed it off, saying Ward C had been abandoned for years and that no one could have been in there. But I knew what I'd seen. I'd seen the last patient, the one they had forgotten, left alone in that dark, crumbling wing, waiting for someone to come back for him. And sometimes, when I'm alone at night, I still hear that faint tapping sound, like a bony finger drumming against metal, reminding me that he's still there, waiting.
Story number 4.
The hospital where I worked was notorious for its endless maze of hallways and for its dark, twisted history. People whispered about eerie occurrences, especially in the old wing. But the story that haunted all of us was about room 13. It was supposed to be empty, had been for years. Yet everyone knew the story of the nurse who haunted it, her ghost forever trapped there after a tragedy decades ago. It was a quiet night shift with only a few patients to check on, and my friend Maria was covering the floor with me. We were exhausted, joking about sneaking naps, but I was the one assigned to check on the patients in the old wing that night. As I made my way down the dimly lit hallway, I passed room 13. Even though it was locked, I always felt a chill when I walked by it. That night, though, something was different. As I passed, I thought I saw a faint light seeping out from under the door. I stopped, heart pounding, and leaned closer. The light flickered, soft and bluish, like the glow of an old lamp. I thought maybe maintenance had forgotten it on, but I remembered Maria telling me they had sealed the room years ago. Taking a deep breath, I knocked softly on the door. To my surprise, it creaked open slightly, as if someone had unlocked it. My instincts screamed at me to walk away, but I couldn't shake the feeling that something was pulling me in. I pushed the door open and my flashlight's beam cut through the darkness. The room was cold, freezing cold. It was furnished like a hospital room from another era, with an old-fashioned bed, a single wooden chair, and a mirror on the wall. Everything was covered in dust, but it felt like someone had been there recently. And then in the corner, I saw her. She was sitting in the chair, dressed in an old nurse's uniform, her head down as if she was studying something in her hands. Her hair was tied in a tight bun, and her pale skin seemed to glow faintly in the dark room. I could barely breathe, my eyes fixed on her as I took a slow step back. But just as I was about to turn and leave, her head snapped up, and her hollow eyes met mine. "Are you here to help me?" she whispered, her voice barely audible. It was filled with a sorrow that made my chest tighten. I froze, unsure of what to say. I could see her features more clearly now. A young woman, maybe in her 20s, with dark circles under her eyes and a haunted expression. I wanted to help her, but I didn't know how. Before I could say a word, she held out her hands, showing me a small silver locket. It looked tarnished, as though it hadn't been touched in years. "They never found him," she whispered, her eyes brimming with tears that shimmered in the dim light. "They promised, but they never found him." I didn't understand what she meant, but her pain was so real, so raw. She stood up, holding the locket to her chest, her gaze distant. I waited. I waited so long, but he never came back. A wave of sorrow washed over me as I realized what must have happened. The story had been passed down for years. A nurse who had fallen in love with a patient. He'd been admitted for a life-threatening condition, and they had formed a deep connection. But he disappeared one night without explanation, and no one ever told her why. Heartbroken and alone, she had locked herself in room 13 and took her own life, hoping to join him in death. As the story ran through my mind, she seemed to sense that I understood. She gave me a sad smile, and for a moment, I thought I saw the faintest hint of peace in her eyes. Then, she held out the locket to me. Hesitantly, I reached out to take it, feeling the cold metal in my hand. It was icy, like it had been lying in the snow. She gave me one last look, then turned toward the bed, lying down as if to finally rest. The light in the room dimmed and the air grew heavy. I felt a strange warmth spread through me, as if some part of her sorrow had lifted. And then, just as suddenly as she had appeared, she was gone. I stood there in stunned silence, clutching the locket, and looked around the empty room. It was completely dark, the only light coming from my flashlight. I left the room, closing the door behind me and locked it, hoping that would keep whatever spirits remained in peace. The next morning, I showed Maria the locket, but she looked at me with confusion. "What locket?" she asked, looking down at my empty hands. I blinked, staring at my own palm. The locket was gone, and yet, I could still feel the coldness of it against my skin, as real as the sorrow that had lingered in that room. To this day, no one has seen the nurse again, but every now and then, when I pass room 13, I swear I can hear a faint whisper, a promise that someone, somewhere, will come back for her. Story the end.
Story number 5.
It was my fourth month working as a nurse on the night shift in the oldest hospital in the city. The building had been around for over 100 years, and it showed. The walls were cracked, the floors creaked, and the lights flickered constantly. Rumor had it that the place was haunted, but I didn't believe in ghosts. That is, until I took the wrong elevator. The hospital had 2 elevators, a new one that everyone used, and an old, creaky one at the far end of the hallway that almost never worked. Maintenance had it shut down years ago, and no one dared to open its doors. But one night, when my shift was nearly over, the new elevator was down for repairs, and I didn't feel like walking down 4 flights of stairs. I decided, against my better judgment, to try the old elevator. It shouldn't have been working, but when I pushed the button, I heard the mechanical whirring of gears, and the doors creaked open. The inside was just as run down as the rest of the hospital, with flickering lights and stained walls, but it was better than hiking down the stairs. I stepped in and pressed the button for the ground floor, relieved when the doors closed and the elevator began its slow descent. But after a few moments, something strange happened. The elevator shuddered to a stop between floors. I jabbed the ground floor button again, but it didn't light up. I tried the emergency button, but it did nothing. Then, as I started to panic, the elevator jolted back to life. Only it wasn't going down anymore. It was going up, higher and higher, past floors that didn't exist in the building, the numbers flashing 5, 6, 7, 8. It shouldn't have been possible. The hospital was only 4 floors tall. I kept my finger on the door open button, but it didn't respond. The air in the elevator grew colder, and a faint smell of decay filled the small space. My heart was pounding, and I could hear my own rapid breathing echoing in the silence. I tried to tell myself it was just a glitch, that any moment it would stop and let me out. But the elevator kept going up, floor after non-existent floor. Finally, it came to a halt. The doors slid open, and I stepped out, relieved to be out of that confined space. But as I looked around, I realized I had no idea where I was. The hallway was dark and silent, the walls lined with dusty medical equipment and old-fashioned stretchers. Everything looked ancient, like it had been abandoned decades ago. The lights flickered dimly, casting eerie shadows that danced along the cracked walls. I felt a chill crawl up my spine as I realized that I was on a floor that didn't exist. I was about to turn back to the elevator when I heard a sound, a faint, dragging noise, like something heavy being pulled across the floor. I froze, straining my ears to pinpoint the direction. The sound was getting closer, accompanied by a soft, labored breathing. I started to back up slowly, keeping my eyes on the end of the hallway. That's when I saw her. A figure appeared in the dim light, barely visible in the shadows. She was dressed in an old hospital gown, her skin pale and lifeless, her hair hanging in tangled clumps around her face. Her eyes were wide and empty, staring straight ahead as she dragged one leg behind her, inching closer to me. Her mouth opened, and she let out a rasping whisper that echoed down the empty hallway. "Help me." I stumbled backward, my heart racing, my entire body frozen in terror. She moved closer, her empty eyes fixed on me as she reached out a hand, skeletal and trembling. I could see bruises on her wrists and dark circles under her hollow eyes, as if she hadn't slept in years. She opened her mouth again, her voice a desperate plea. "Please, don't leave me here." I turned and bolted back toward the elevator, hitting the button repeatedly, willing the doors to open. The old woman's footsteps grew faster, the dragging sound louder as she approached. Just as she was inches away, the elevator doors opened, and I stumbled inside, frantically pressing the ground floor button. The doors closed just as her hand reached the threshold, and I watched in horror as her face appeared, pressed against the glass. She stared at me with those empty, haunted eyes, her mouth moving as she whispered something I couldn't hear. Then, the elevator began to descend, and her face disappeared. I leaned against the wall, panting, my heart hammering in my chest. When the elevator doors finally opened again, I was on the ground floor. I stumbled out, looking around in a daze. The hospital was quiet, as if nothing had happened. I hurried back to the nurse's station, hoping to find someone to tell what I'd just seen, but no one was there. I sat down, trying to steady my breathing, when I noticed an old photo on the wall behind the desk. The photo showed a group of nurses from decades ago, all standing in front of the hospital. My blood ran cold as my eyes settled on one of the figures in the picture, the woman from the elevator, staring blankly at the camera, the same empty eyes that had begged me for help. I later found out that the old elevator used to be the only access to a special isolation ward on the fifth floor. It had been shut down after an accident in which several patients and a nurse were trapped during a fire, unable to escape. No one had survived. Now, I avoid that end of the hallway and take the stairs, no matter how exhausted I am. But sometimes, late at night, I hear the faint whir of the elevator, moving up to floors that shouldn't exist, and a soft, pleading voice whispering, "Help me." Story the end.
Story number 6.
Working nights in the hospital morgue wasn't exactly what I dreamed of as a medical intern, but I needed the hours and I was desperate. The morgue was cold, quiet, and, to most, unnerving. But after a few weeks, I'd gotten used to it, until the night that I'll never forget. It was a little past midnight, and I was updating records on a recent arrival, an older man who had passed away just hours before. A storm was raging outside, making the lights flicker occasionally, casting eerie shadows across the rows of steel drawers. As I filled out the paperwork, I heard a soft sound, like a shuffle or a scuff coming from deeper in the room. I paused, listening. It sounded like it was coming from one of the drawers, the kind where we stored the bodies. I shook my head, telling myself it was just the building settling. But the sound continued, now accompanied by a faint tapping, like someone was scratching at the inside of the metal. I swallowed, my hands starting to shake. Rationalizing that it was probably just an animal or a trick of the storm, I forced myself to investigate. I approached the row of drawers, feeling the icy air chill my face. The noise grew louder as I got closer. It was coming from drawer 17, the one where I'd just placed the older man. Taking a deep breath, I pulled the drawer open. The man lay there, still and silent, his face pale in the harsh fluorescent light. I leaned in, looking for anything unusual, but there was nothing, just the man, lifeless and still. I was about to slide the drawer shut when his eyes opened. I jumped back, stifling a scream, my mind struggling to comprehend what I was seeing. His eyes, once closed in peaceful repose, were now wide open, staring up at the ceiling. And then, in a barely audible voice, he whispered, "Help me." I froze. He was dead. There was no way he could be alive. My heart pounded as I considered the impossible. Could we have made a mistake? I grabbed his wrist, frantically searching for a pulse, but his skin was ice cold. There was nothing. But his eyes continued to stare, and his mouth moved again, his voice a hoarse rasp. "Help me," he gasped, his voice barely a whisper. I could see his lips tremble, his fingers twitch. My mind raced. I didn't know what to do. I should call someone, get help, but I was rooted to the spot, my legs frozen with terror. Just then, the lights flickered again, plunging the room into darkness for a brief, agonizing moment. When they came back on, the drawer was empty. The man's body was gone. I staggered backward, my mind reeling. I checked every drawer, every inch of the morgue, but there was no sign of him. I ran to the records, convinced I'd somehow misplaced him, but his paperwork was right there in front of me. Trying to calm myself, I went back to my desk, intending to write up an incident report. I told myself that I'd imagined it, that the stress of the long hours had finally gotten to me. But as I sat down, I felt a chill settle over my shoulders, as if someone were standing directly behind me. I turned slowly, and there he was, standing in the doorway, his eyes hollow, his face twisted in an expression of pain and terror. His mouth opened again, that same plea spilling from his lips. "Help me." Before I could react, the lights flickered once more, and when they steadied, he was gone. I ran out of the morgue and didn't look back. When I returned the next day with my supervisor, there was no record of the man ever being admitted. No paperwork, no identification, nothing, as if he had never existed. Now, whenever I'm on the night shift and the lights flicker, I swear I can feel that same chill creep up my spine, and I hear his whisper echoing in the silence. "Help me."
Story number 7.
The hospital was almost empty when I started my shift that night. The storm had caused power outages across the city, so only the sickest patients remained, tucked away in the shadows of dim emergency lighting. As a new nurse, I was still getting used to the eerie quiet of the night shift, and I tried to focus on my rounds to keep my nerves steady. Around midnight, I got a call from the nurse's station. "Room 4007. The patient needs attention," said a voice over the line. Static crackled, and then silence. I frowned. I didn't remember anyone being checked into room 407 tonight, but figured maybe it was a last-minute transfer. Grabbing my supplies, I made my way to the fourth floor. The hallway was silent, except for the faint hum of the generator. The lights flickered as I walked, casting strange shadows along the empty rooms. Finally, I reached room 407 and hesitated. The door was slightly open, and a thin beam of light spilled out into the hall. Taking a breath, I pushed it open. Inside, the room looked untouched, like it hadn't been used in years. Dust covered the bed, and the sheets were pulled tight and undisturbed. But then I saw him, a frail, elderly man lying there, staring blankly at the ceiling, his skin so pale he almost blended into the sheets. His chest rose and fell with shallow, uneven breaths. "Sir?" I said softly, approaching him. "Did you need something?" He turned his head slowly, his eyes glassy and unfocused. "Water," he rasped, his voice barely a whisper. I looked around for a pitcher or glass, but there was nothing. "I'll be right back," I assured him, hurrying to the supply room down the hall. As I filled a glass of water, I felt uneasy, but I pushed the feeling away, telling myself I was just jumpy from the storm. When I returned to room 407, the bed was empty. Confused, I set the glass down and checked under the bed, the bathroom, and even the hallway outside. There was no trace of him. I rushed back to the nurse's station, hoping someone could explain. "Who was the patient in room 407? I asked the head nurse, trying to keep the panic out of my voice. She looked at me, frowning. "Room 407? She paused, her expression shifting to something darker. "We haven't used that room in years. They closed it down after..." Her voice trailed off. "After what?" I pressed. She looked away, as if reluctant to share. "There was a patient there, an older man, left alone during another bad storm like tonight's. The power went out, and the nurses didn't notice he'd stopped breathing until hours later." She shivered. "Since then, people say they've seen him on stormy nights, calling for water, waiting for someone to help him." I felt a chill settle over me. "But I saw him. He spoke to me," I stammered. The head nurse just gave me a knowing look. "It's best to let him be." I went back to room 407, unable to shake the urge to check one last time. The bed was empty, the room silent. But on the nightstand, next to the undisturbed dust, was the glass of water I'd left, completely empty. Story the end.
Story number 8.
When I took my job as a night shift nurse at Maplewood Hospital, I thought I was prepared for anything. But nothing could have prepared me for the night I encountered the haunted call light. It was my second week on the job, and I was still trying to find my rhythm. The hospital was quiet, with only a few patients scattered across the floor. I made my rounds, checking on each patient and ensuring they were comfortable. Most were asleep, the rhythmic beeping of monitors a constant backdrop to the silence of the night. Around 2 a.m., I entered room 312. The lights were dim, and the air felt heavy, as if it were holding its breath. In the bed lay Mrs. Thompson, a sweet old woman with a kind smile. I checked her vitals and noticed she was sound asleep. But then, out of the corner of my eye, I caught the flicker of her call light. The call light in the corner blinked insistently, casting an eerie glow against the dark walls. I frowned, confused. I hadn't heard her buzz for help, and she seemed perfectly fine. I moved closer, reaching for the switch to turn it off. As soon as my fingers brushed the light, it turned off, and the room plunged back into darkness. I chuckled nervously, thinking it must have been a malfunction, but just as I was about to leave, the light blinked back on, illuminating the room once more. "Mrs. Thompson?" I asked, glancing back at her. She remained still, her eyes closed, her breathing even. A chill ran down my spine as I stepped back, unsure of what was happening. I decided to call the nurse's station to report the malfunction. As I turned to leave, the call light flickered again, but this time it wasn't just the light. A voice echoed from the darkness, soft but distinct. "Help me." I froze. It was a woman's voice, tinged with desperation. I turned back to the bed, and Mrs. Rahat Thompson was still asleep, her face serene. I hesitated, my heart racing. "Hello?" I called, but there was only silence. Suddenly, the air turned cold, and I felt a presence behind me. I turned slowly, half expecting to see someone standing there. Instead, the room was empty, but the light above the door flickered ominously, casting shadows on the walls. I took a step back, ready to bolt for the door, when the call light started flashing again, this time accompanied by the soft sound of sobbing. I gripped the edge of the bed, trying to steady myself. "Is anyone there?" I called out again, my voice trembling. The sobbing grew louder, more frantic, and I felt an overwhelming urge to turn off the call light again. I stepped forward, but as my fingers brushed the light, a cold gust of wind swept through the room, snuffing out the faint glow. The darkness enveloped me, and I could hear the cries echoing all around me. Panic set in. I turned to leave, but the door slammed shut. I pounded on it, yelling for help, but the sobbing continued, wrapping around me like a suffocating blanket. I glanced back at Mrs. Thompson, and my heart sank. She was no longer asleep. Her eyes were wide open, staring past me with an expression of sheer terror. "Help her," she rasped, her voice barely a whisper. "You have to help her." Before I could respond, the light flickered back on, illuminating the room once again, but this time the figure of a woman stood at the foot of the bed. She was translucent, her face twisted in anguish. "Help me," she pleaded, her voice echoing with sorrow. I felt paralyzed, caught between fear and compassion. "What do you need?" I asked, my voice trembling. "Find me," she whispered, her form flickering like a candle in the wind. "They left me here." In that moment, I understood. This wasn't just a random haunting. This was a plea for help from someone who had been forgotten. With every ounce of courage I could muster, I shouted, "I will help you." As soon as the words left my mouth, the woman let out a piercing scream and the lights flickered violently. I stumbled back, covering my ears, and then suddenly everything went dark. The call light went out, and I was enveloped in silence. When the lights came back on, I found myself alone in the room. The woman was gone, and Mrs. Thompson looked at me with wide eyes, filled with understanding. "You saw her, didn't you?" she asked, her voice shaking. I nodded, feeling a strange mix of relief and dread. "Yes, who was she?" Mrs. Thompson's face grew solemn. "She was a patient here long ago, left alone when no one came for her. They say her spirit haunts this room, waiting for someone to remember her." I felt a chill run down my spine, but then I remembered my resolve. "I'll find out what happened to her," I promised. The call light flickered one last time, as if in acknowledgement. From that night on, I dedicated my shifts to uncovering the truth about the ghostly visitor of Room 312. I researched old records and spoke to longtime staff members determined to give her the closure she needed. Eventually, I learned that the woman had died in that very room, forgotten and alone. I held a small vigil in her memory, lighting a candle and saying a prayer. And from that night forward, the call light never flickered again.
Story number 9.
I always thought of myself as a rational person, someone who relied on logic and facts. But all of that changed during my first week as a nurse in the late night shift at Hawthorne General Hospital. The building itself was a relic, old, creaky, with an unsettling aura that sent shivers down my spine. Most of the nurses warned me about Room 301, saying it was cursed. They said strange things happened there, that you could hear voices and see shadows. Of course, I dismissed it as mere superstition. One particularly stormy night, while most of the staff huddled in the lounge, I was tasked with making my rounds alone. The rain hammered against the windows and the wind howled, creating an eerie ambiance that made the hair on the back of my neck stand on end. I began my checks on the patients, making sure they were comfortable, when I remembered Room 301. It was one of the few rooms I hadn't visited yet, and I felt a strange pull to it. As I approached, the air grew colder, and I felt a shiver run down my spine. The door to Room 301 was slightly ajar, creaking softly as I pushed it open. The room was dim, lit only by the pale light of the emergency exit sign. It was empty, but something felt off. The bed was neatly made, and the chair in the corner sat undisturbed. I turned to leave when I heard it, a soft, childlike giggle coming from the corner of the room. My heart raced. I turned around slowly, half expecting to see a child playing or a nurse joking around, but there was nothing, just shadows dancing across the walls. "Hello?" I called out, trying to keep my voice steady. "Is anyone there?" Silence, just the sound of the rain pounding against the window. I took a deep breath and stepped further into the room. Then, as I turned to leave, I caught a glimpse of movement out of the corner of my eye. A figure, a small girl in a pale white dress, stood by the window, her back to me. I froze, my heart racing. "Hey, are you lost?" I called, my voice trembling. The girl didn't respond. She simply stood there, her hair falling over her shoulders. I took a cautious step forward, and the girl slowly turned to face me. Her face was pale, her eyes wide and empty, like two black voids staring right through me. "Help me," she whispered, her voice barely audible over the storm outside. I felt a cold chill wash over me, but I couldn't bring myself to run. "What do you need help with?" I asked, my voice shaky. The girl pointed to the bed, then looked back at me, her expression filled with despair. "He's coming," she said, her voice trembling. "You have to save him." Before I could respond, the room filled with a low, rumbling sound that seemed to shake the very walls. I stumbled back, my breath catching in my throat. The girl's eyes widened in fear, and she vanished in an instant, leaving nothing but a lingering chill in the air. Panicked, I turned to flee the room, but the door slammed shut, trapping me inside. I banged on it, yelling for help, but the storm outside roared even louder, drowning out my cries. I felt a presence behind me and turned slowly, my heart pounding. There, looming in the shadows, was a figure, a man, his face gaunt and twisted in anger. "You shouldn't have come here," he growled, his voice echoing like thunder. I bolted for the window, desperate to escape, but it wouldn't budge. I turned back to face him, and the girl reappeared beside him, her face now twisted in terror. "Run," she screamed. "He won't let you leave." I lunged for the door again, and this time it swung open as if an unseen force had released it. I ran into the hallway, the sound of my own heartbeat drowning out the storm. I glanced back, and the room was empty, just a cold, silent shell. I found the nearest nurse and told her everything, but she just shook her head, a knowing look in her eyes. "That room is haunted," she said softly. "The little girl died here years ago. Her father was a patient. They say he lost his mind and took her life." Shaken to my core, I tried to shake off the encounter, but every time the storm rolled in, I felt that same chill creeping up my spine, the echo of that little girl's voice begging for help. Now, I always avoid room 301. Some nights, when the wind howls and the rain beats against the windows, I can still hear her whisper, "Help me," echoing in the halls, reminding me that some ghosts never truly leave.
Story number 10.
It was one of the few rooms I hadn't visited yet, and I felt a strange pull to it. As I approached, the air grew colder, and I felt a shiver run down my spine. The door to room 301 was slightly ajar, creaking softly as I pushed it open. The room was dim, lit only by the pale light of the emergency exit sign. It was empty, but something felt off. The bed was neatly made, and the chair in the corner sat undisturbed. I turned to leave when I heard it, a soft, childlike giggle coming from the corner of the room. My heart raced. I turned around slowly, half expecting to see a child playing or a nurse joking around. But there was nothing, just shadows dancing across the walls. "Hello?" I called out, trying to keep my voice steady. "Is anyone there?" Silence. Just the sound of the rain pounding against the window. I took a deep breath and stepped further into the room. Then, as I turned to leave, I caught a glimpse of movement out of the corner of my eye. A figure, a small girl in a pale white dress, stood by the window, her back to me. I froze, my heart racing. "Hey, are you lost?" I called, my voice trembling. The girl didn't respond. She simply stood there, her hair falling over her shoulders. I took a cautious step forward, and the girl slowly turned to face me. Her face was pale, her eyes wide and empty, like two black voids staring right through me. "Help me," she whispered, her voice barely audible over the storm outside. I felt a cold chill wash over me, but I couldn't bring myself to run. "What do you need help with?" I asked, my voice shaky. The girl pointed to the bed, then looked back at me, her expression filled with despair. "He's coming," she said, her voice trembling. "You have to save him." Before I could respond, the room filled with a low, rumbling sound that seemed to shake the very walls. I stumbled back, my breath catching in my throat. The girl's eyes widened in fear, and she vanished in an instant, leaving nothing but a lingering chill in the air. Panicked, I turned to flee the room, but the door slammed shut, trapping me inside. I banged on it, yelling for help, but the storm outside roared even louder, drowning out my cries. I felt a presence behind me and turned slowly, my heart pounding. There, looming in the shadows, was a figure, a man, his face gaunt and twisted in anger. "You shouldn't have come here," he growled, his voice echoing like thunder. I bolted for the window, desperate to escape, but it wouldn't budge. I turned back to face him, and the girl reappeared beside him, her face now twisted in terror. "Run," she screamed. "He won't let you leave." I lunged for the door again, and this time it swung open as if an unseen force had released it. I ran into the hallway, the sound of my own heartbeat drowning out the storm. I glanced back, and the room was empty, just a cold, silent shell. I found the nearest nurse and told her everything, but she just shook her head, a knowing look in her eyes. "That room is haunted," she said softly. "The little girl died here years ago. Her father was a patient. They say he lost his mind and took her life." Shaken to my core, I tried to shake off the encounter, but every time the storm rolled in, I felt that same chill creeping up my spine, the echo of that little girl's voice begging for help. Now, I always avoid room 301. Some nights, when the wind howls and the rain beats against the windows, I can still hear her whisper, "Help me," echoing in the halls, reminding me that some ghosts never truly leave. It was one of the few rooms I hadn't visited yet, and I felt a strange pull to it. As I approached, the air grew colder, and I felt a shiver run down my spine. The door to room 301 was slightly ajar, creaking softly as I pushed it open. The room was dim, lit only by the pale light of the emergency exit sign. It was empty, but something felt off. The bed was neatly made, and the chair in the corner sat undisturbed. I turned to leave when I heard it, a soft, childlike giggle coming from the corner of the room. My heart raced. I turned around slowly, half expecting to see a child playing or a nurse joking around. But there was nothing, just shadows dancing across the walls. "Hello?" I called out, trying to keep my voice steady. "Is anyone there?" Silence. Just the sound of the rain pounding against the window. I took a deep breath and stepped further into the room. Then, as I turned to leave, I caught a glimpse of movement out of the corner of my eye. A figure, a small girl in a pale white dress, stood by the window, her back to me. I froze, my heart racing. "Hey, are you lost?" I called, my voice trembling. The girl didn't respond. She simply stood there, her hair falling over her shoulders. I took a cautious step forward, and the girl slowly turned to face me. Her face was pale, her eyes wide and empty, like two black voids staring right through me. "Help me," she whispered, her voice barely audible over the storm outside.